Larry Bottomley here is on my right, bringing us up to date with Chariot Oil and Gas's latest news. Now, that's an independent Atlantic Margins oil and gas exploration company. 3 licenses offshore Morocco, 4 Brazil, 1 license covering 2 blocks in Namibia. And that asset due to be drilled later on this year. Chariot said to be well-funded ahead of a very exciting year for them. So I'll just hand over now to Chariot CEO Larry Bottomley. Thank you.
Thank you, Polly. Thank you, everybody, for attending. I will be making forward-looking statements, and this slide covers the context for those statements. Well, why Chariot? As Polly's just described, we're an Atlantic Margins exploration company. To some, exploration's a mystery, so the way that I've chosen to describe it here is in terms of means, motive, and opportunity, because that's generally the best way to try and solve most mysteries. In terms of means, we have an excellent cash position. Our cash exceeds our commitments. We've got a broad portfolio that I'll be describing of drill-ready, giant-scale opportunities, and we have a well that we'll be drilling this year that's fully funded. In terms of motive, what we're looking to do is to create transformational value, which has already been spoken to. For us, transformational value will come through the discovery of giant-scale reserves. So we've built a portfolio of giant-scale opportunities throughout these assets that we'll be looking to drill during the course of the next 2 years. And in terms of opportunity, what we have been able to do over the last 3 years and what we're looking to do over the next year is to capture the bottom of the cost cycle. And by capturing the bottom of the cost cycle, we can drill wells now at a material and significant fraction of what they would have cost before 2014. I won't spend any additional time on means and motive, but what I will do now is to go through and describe the opportunity that that we see in the industry and within our portfolio. In terms of that opportunity and why now, there was a significant oil price drop in 2014, and when the oil price dropped, costs followed that drop, specifically seismic. Seismic responded instantly. Through 2015, 2016, and 2017, we acquired very large volumes of 3D seismic data in Brazil, Namibia, and Morocco, respectively. And that 3D data is absolutely essential for the de-risking process. Drilling rates and drilling rigs, they responded more slowly, as can be seen on the graph on the left-hand side. Rig rates, deep water rig rates, $650,000 a day, they've now gone down to less than $140,000 a day. Last year, Ophir drilled the ultra-deep water well Ayami 1X in Côte d'Ivoire, and they drilled that well for $19 million, a well that would have cost in the region of $100 million prior to that collapse. We hired Ophir's drilling manager. He worked with me when I was at Perenco, and we've replicated now much of that Ophir drilling team in-house in Chariot, and they will be managing the drilling of Prospect S for us in Namibia in the fourth quarter of this year. And our aim is to replicate the costs that were delivered from that Ophir drilling. So we're looking to capitalize on the bottom of the cost cycle. We certainly did that seismically. We made away like bandits in maturing our portfolio in Brazil, Namibia, and Morocco, and we're looking to do the same with drilling. This photo at the bottom, our team went out to Canaries in November last year to look at the Saipem 12,000 rig. This was the rig that drilled our well, our unsuccessful well in Morocco that I'll describe later. That drill ship isn't in that photo. And at that time, these were 6 deep water units, two drill ships and 4 floaters, stacked, waiting, and desperate to get contracts. So we're capitalizing on that drilling market that's available. There is a return to exploration, the graph on the top right-hand side. Companies are coming back through to exploration. Because of reserve replacement and the way the oil price has responded. So we see that this window for low drilling costs is temporal. It will close in the next 18 months to potentially 2 years. So going through our specific assets, firstly with Namibia, We have the central blocks, the orange license up on the map on the left-hand side. We're partnered there with Azinam, Namcor, and BE. We operate that license with 65% equity. It's a huge block, 16,000 square kilometers, and we have 6,100 square kilometers of 3D seismic data in that block. Exploration has returned to Namibia. The oil price has made that happen, but also because of well results that have occurred within the basin. There are two wells immediately to the north of our license, Morombe and Wingat, and these wells proved all of the key elements of the petroleum system. Morombe found excellent quality Cretaceous sands. Both wells, both that Morombe well and the Wingat well, found world-class, mature, oil-prone source rocks. The combination of those elements, it demonstrates the petroleum system, and as a consequence, we've now had significant companies come into the basin. So our near neighbours are Exxon, Mobil, Shell, Total, Tullow, ONGC, and many others. And there's going to be a two-well program this year, additional wells next year, and we'll be part of that that two-well program this year. In our license, in our central blocks, we've identified five very large four-way dip-closed structures. The one that we'll be drilling is on this slide here. This is Prospect S. It's a large four-way dip closure, and this prospect has those reservoirs that were proven in Morombe. So the R on that slide, these are the wells that were encountered in Morombe. It also has the source rocks that were encountered in both Morombe and Wingat, the diamonds on this map, and that source rock is mature within our blocks. Netherland, Sewell assign 459 million barrels of prospective resource to this prospect in the gross mean prospective case. It's in the 1,500 meters of water. We'll drill 2,600 meters of sediment within that well, and that will be spud mid to late October this year. Operational planning and contracting is well advanced. We've secured the ocean rig Poseidon that will be drilling this well, and we expect the gross well cost of this to be between $20 and $25 million, and that well is fully funded. In the block, there are these additional five-way dip-closed structures. This is an isometric view, a seismic line at the back, a structure map at the bottom, and then this worm-type geometry. These are the sand systems that are progressing from the screen out towards you. Prospect S sits at the top of that sand system. There are additional structural closures down that sand system. There's Prospect V that sits on top of it, and Prospect W that sits on top of it. Both V and W, those sands cut into the source rock. In a younger, shallower sand system, there are additional two four-way dip closures within that feature, one of which is shown here, V. So we've got five four-way dip closures. They range from 290 million barrels up to 459 million barrels, 1.75 billion barrels of prospective resource. If S is a discovery, it will de-risk that additional 1.75 billion barrels of prospective resource. And we have an additional two stratigraphic prospects in excess of 400 million barrels that sit below these four-way dip closures. So that's Namibia, the well that we were drilling this year. Moving on to our opportunity in Brazil, which we access by translating our Atlantic margins knowledge and understanding in Africa across to the conjugate margin in Brazil. The map on the top right-hand side is a gravity bathymetry map, and what that shows is that the basin that we're in, the Barreirinhas Basin, is conjugate to Ghana and Côte d'Ivoire, where there have been in excess of 10 billion barrels of reserves that have been discovered over a 10-year period. And these basins share the same source system and the same potential trapping geometries. This basin, the Barreirinhas Basin, we were successful in round 11. This was the most competitive basin in that round, over $300 million of signature bonus that were paid by the industry in this block. And there will be 11 wells that have been committed into this basin. We secured our licenses, the four blocks in orange on the right-hand side, for $2 million and a seismic option. The neighboring block, which you can see on the seismic line through there, our block is on the left, The neighbouring block is on the right. That block was secured for $75 million, and it has a committed well. So that well has the potential to de-risk our block, and our block sits up dip of that licence. So the commitment that we had in the block was 3D seismic data. That's been completed, acquired, processed, and interpreted. Within the basin, within the deep water part of the basin, there are three wells. The nearest basin has thick, excellent quality turbidite sands, and we can correlate those sands from that well onto our block. In shallow water, there are a number of wells that have got proven excellent source rocks, and we map those source rocks as being mature in our basin. This seismic line shows the structure that we identify, a 200 square kilometer feature, and sitting about, above, and below that are a number of stratigraphic and structural targets. We have seven targets, and these individual targets range up to 366 million barrels. Prospect one, a single well, could penetrate three of those targets, and that prospective resource is 911 million barrels in that of gross mean prospective resource within that that well, again as audited by Netherland, Sewell. On to Morocco and our opportunity there. We have three license sets within Morocco: Rabat Deep in the west, where we partnered with ENI, Woodside, and Onim, and then Kenitra and Mohammedia in the east, where we operate with 75%. We drilled the unsuccessful Rabat Deep 1 well, and that completed in April of this year, and that was in the Rabat Deep license. That was operated by ENI. That well was targeting the JP1 prospect, a 200 square kilometer four-way dip-closed Jurassic carbonate structure. The carbonates were tight. There was no reservoir. There were no holes in that reservoir, so there was no space for any hydrocarbons to accumulate within that within those holes. We did have shows. It demonstrates the petroleum system. It's never good drilling a dry well, certainly as a frontier exploration company, but it's best that if those wells are drilled, that they're drilled at zero cost. We were very fortunate in that we're able to partner during the course of the program on this license, an original 75% equity. We partnered with Woodside, having acquired 3D data. We acquired with Woodside, and they paid for the 3D data. The evaluation of the 3D data, we then partnered for ENI, and ENI fully carried us in that well. So that well was no cost to the company, and that's what we look to attempt to do in all of the major investment phases throughout our portfolio. Now, the important thing from a petroleum systems point of view is that the well did penetrate a thick, effective top seal. So above the blue, which is the JP1 carbonate structure, sitting above that was a thick top seal. And in that top seal, there were thin sands that were subseismic. You couldn't image them on the seismic because they were too thin to be able to resolve. And that that seal and reservoir system is the same age as our targets in Mohammedia and Kenitra. So this line through here goes from west to east. We're targeting sands that sit within that section that were demonstrated within the well. We're currently taking all of the well information that we've got from the Rabat Deep, undertaking rock properties and evaluations to try and understand what fluids would look like seismically in the prospects that we've got. So by undertaking fluid substitutions, putting in water, oil, and gas, what does that seismic signature look like, and how does it compare to our data? Now, on the left-hand side here, this is a map of one of the targets that we've got in these prospects, and this is a display that shows where the faults and the fault structures might be. So within that, it's very easy to see the faults and the fault geometries that occur across that across the feature. What we've also been able to do is to extract from the 3D seismic data the anomalies. These are class 3 AVO anomalies, which are really important low-risk indicators. So what's green on that map has the potential to be very low-risk for hydrocarbon-bearing bearing geometry. And the important thing with that green on the map is it drapes over the top of the structure. and it and the feature itself. The AVO conforms the structure, again, a very good low-risk indicator, and there's a very clearly defined trapping geometry. And that trapping geometry is over 70 square kilometers, and it has a number of stacked targets within it. So this is representative one of these group of prospects in this shallower play that we'll be targeting in our future drilling within Morocco. This map shows the geographic range of those targets. These make up the LKP group of prospects that we've identified. And these individual prospects range from 260 million barrels up to 350 million barrels. The individual prospects themselves add up to a billion barrels of prospective gross mean prospective resource with what we've identified that has these seismic attributes that we're looking to calibrate from the well that we've done. So what we're doing is we're incorporating the well data. We acquired 3D seismic data over these licenses in March of last year. We received that data at the beginning of this year. We'll be completing that evaluation and then go out to partner, which we expect to do in the next few months. Because of the calibration with the well and what we're seeing on the data, we do expect both the prospective resources to improve from our current description and also for the probability of geological status, P sub G, to improve as we go through that program because we will have calibrated seismic fascias. So in terms of the investment case, what we're attempting to do as Chariot is to be exposed to the outcome of the drilling of these giant potential prospects. Success in any one of these prospects would create transformational value. But the important thing with all of our portfolio is any single success in any license liberates the running room and the upside in the additional prospects that sit within that acreage. And that's what the graphs on the bottom left and the bottom right are looking to indicate, is to illustrate the scale of the prize that we're focused on. Now, the bottom left-hand graph, what I've done is to populate our drilling inventory, the three prospects that we're looking to drill over the next 2 years, in with the 2P2C reserve base of a number of companies that you'll know. Really important to recognize that prospective resources are not reserves. They need to be discovered in the scale and the nature that they're being discovered. But so this is an apples and oranges graph, but what it does do is it shows the resource, the net resource that we're looking to expose ourselves if we were to be successful. So Prospect S, the well we're drilling in Namibia, in the fourth quarter of this year, that's bigger than Cairn's 2P2C reserve base. So the prospect that we are targeting within Kenitra, that's almost twice in the prospect that I showed, that's twice the size of Ken's 2P2C reserve base. And then the prospect one that we're targeting within Brazil, that's slightly bigger than Premier. Really important, 2P reserves are not prospective resources, but that's the scale of resource that we're trying to expose our company and our shareholders to as we go through this exploration program. So, in terms of Chariot and the portfolio, transformational impact, we've built this portfolio. Individual opportunities themselves are material. Prospect S, FinCap assigned 23p a share risked on that prospect. In the success case, that rises to 173p a share. So clearly, a 10 bagger to a significant degree in that success case. And that represents the scale of uplift that we're looking at within all of the opportunities that we're exposing ourselves to. And that 23p a share, 173p a share, assigns no value for the additional four-way dip closures. It assigns no value to the additional stratigraphic trap. So S could give us a Cairn-scale asset base, but it would de-risk a portfolio that has a significant running room associated with it. And with S, the well is fully funded as we go through the program. What we have been doing during the course of the cycle, the bottom of the cycle, is to continue to invest in our portfolio, large volumes of 3D data, so we can build a drilling inventory, a portfolio that's drill ready that we can go through and partner on. And within that portfolio, any success liberates the subsequent running room. We have an exciting 2 years ahead. This is the drilling program that we're targeting. With Prospect S, that goes ahead. We are looking to partner on Prospect S. Any money that we can get a third party to contribute to that well means that we can invest that in the subsequent appraisal program on S or the follow-on exploration program, or to fold that onto the rest of the portfolio. And we've got a data room currently open in Brazil, and we'll be opening one in Morocco shortly. So we've got a very exciting 2 years ahead. We'll continue to undertake and prosecute our exploration program, and I hope that you consider joining us in what's going to be a very exciting ride.
Very possibly. Thank you. Right, so that Q&A session begins. Hands raised, please. Microphones will be handed to you. Sir, on the front row, thank you.
Could you say anything about the shows? Were they oil or gas? Was it in the Jurassic or the Cretaceous? And was it even biogenic gas like Repsol or Anchois further north?
The shows were in the Jurassic, and they were oil and gas.
Never heard a question like that before. Dead impressed. Second row here, please.
How keen are you to farm out on Prospect S? I mean, is it? Would you say if you don't farm out on Prospect S, you will have enough resource to continue with the rest of the program?
Yes. The in terms of the commitments that we've got, the only commitment that we've got throughout the entire portfolio is the Prospect S well. So, and we'll be drilling that. We'll be drilling that well, and we're funded for it. Regardless of whether we partner, we are very keen to partner because what that allows us to do is, in Prospect S specifically, with five four-way dip closures, explore, discover, sell, our preference would be on partnering is to be able to drill S and then drill W back-to-back with S. That proves up two of the five prospects. It proves up two different source kitchens, and it de-risks the remainder of the portfolio. So by partnering, it allows us to drill S. S is a discovery. We would drill W back to back. We've got the well on a 1+1
basis. Obviously, if you fail on S without being farmed out, you can be a bit stuck to continue with the rest of the program, because S is going to cost, what, $19 million, and you've got, 35 million in the bank? So, with GNA as well, you know, I'd say if you don't farm out on S, you've probably been looking to raise or pre-drill.
We're looking to partner in all of our portfolio. So if we partner on S, then that's great. That the cash that's liberated that we're not spending on S, we can invest in elsewhere in the program. But we're also looking to partner on Brazil. So partnering on Brazil, any cash that liberates, we can invest elsewhere. We'll be looking to partner in Morocco. Anything that we liberate there will go elsewhere. So it's really about just continuing to continue our process of taking large equity positions and then going through the partner process. We have historically been successful at partnering. Partnering has been really very tough over the last 2 or 3 years. We're one of the few companies that have been successful at partnering over the last 2 or 3 years, but we have historically partnered with Petrobras, BP, Cairn, Eni, Woodside, Azinam. So we are continuing. I mean, that's part of the de-risking process that we're undertaking.
Thank you.